Beethoven's Diabelli variations owe their existence to an external stimulus. A project of the Viennese publisher Antonio Diabelli, who in the year 1819 sent a waltz of his own invention to Austria's 50 most illustrious composers, asking each to contribute a single variation. The contributors included Mozart's son, Franz Schubert, the 12-year-old Franz Liszt, the Archduke Rudolf, Karl Czerny, and others. The reaction Diabelli got from Beethoven, though, was not enthusiastic. Here is Diabelli's waltz. In spite of its rustic vitality, Beethoven seems not to have been very impressed by the theme. He described it as a Schusterfleck, or cobbler's patch, and reportedly said he would not contribute to the project. Despite this initial reaction, however, Beethoven soon became very interested in the theme, so interested that he composed not one, but 23 variations on the waltz, as we know from research done on Beethoven's musical sketchbooks. Beethoven's voluminous sketches and drafts for works provide a detailed record of his compositional activities. In the case of the Diabelli variations, an early draft for the work can be reconstructed from several scattered manuscript sources held in different European collections. At the time Beethoven began composition of the Diabelli variations, he was nearly 50 years old and was in the midst of a series of gigantic projects. He was about to compose the Missa Solemnis and was also at work on the Ninth Symphony. From the manuscripts, we know that in the spring of 1819, Beethoven wrote out a draft containing 23 variations on Diabelli's waltz, 10 fewer than the final number, and he then put the project aside to finish it 4 years later. Let's look and see how Beethoven treats Diabelli's theme in variations stemming from 1819. It's not the total shape of the theme that seems to interest Beethoven most, but rather the component elements, or basic motives, which are isolated and reformulated so that features of the theme that Diabelli could not have regarded as too important become essential in some of Beethoven's variations. For example, this little turn, which is an accessory in the waltz, becomes in Beethoven's ninth variation the whole basis for the texture. Whereas in variation 11, the same idea of the turn is absorbed into a piece of entirely different character. Beethoven also extracts humorous possibilities from the theme, as, for example, in variation 13. This variation provides a comic interpretation of the opening of Diabelli's theme, in which static or repetitious elements are dissolved into silence. This is shown in Beethoven's variation by the forceful chords followed by rests, and by the grotesquely humorous shifts in register, especially in the second half. Another example of the humorous possibilities, or opportunities for caricature, is provided by variation 21, in which Beethoven seizes upon some of these aspects of the waltz, the repeated chords and the turn, and overdoes it in that instead of 10 repetitions of the chords, we have 16. Instead of one turn, we have a whole series of trills over the entire keyboard, exaggerating these features that might be regarded as trite, so that in a sense they become insufferably so. So why didn't Beethoven finish off the piece in 1819? That's an intriguing question, and an answer is suggested, I think, by the manner in which he completed it. In 1823, Beethoven left the order of the 23 completed variations intact. What he did was to insert at strategic points some new variations, enough to build up the end of the work in an unprecedented way. Several of the freshly composed variations from 1823 have something in common that is conspicuously absent from the variations that Beethoven had written in the core of the work finished several years earlier. What he had generally deleted in transforming the theme were the elements we would regard as the most repetitious, static, or perhaps banal. That is, for example, the chords repeated 10 times with a crescendo on the tonic, and then 10 times again on the dominant. One can understand why he would have avoided and transformed this aspect of the waltz. But what is remarkable is that when he came back to the piece in 1823, he singled out precisely these elements and included them in a series of variations that refer directly back to the theme, each time in the original register of the waltz. As in other variation sets by Beethoven, there is a procedure of recapitulating the melodic shape of the theme at intervals to remind the listener of the original shape of the theme after it has gone through many transformations. And in this case, another factor is an element of exaggeration, which tends to occur in these variations. Not only do we have the original melodic contour, the original affective character of the waltz brought back, but elements of the waltz are exaggerated through the use of dissonance, unusual voice leading, or the humorous use of missing measures. Thus, there is a trend toward an ironic caricature of the theme. The first variation that Beethoven included in this vein is variation 1 of the finished work, which is a march, quite majestic, but in a sense stilted as well, because it maintains the melodic contour of the waltz so closely. Here, at the opening of the march, the bass spells out the descending fourth from the waltz. Creating accented clashes with the right hand. This variation shows a tendency towards caricature that is more evident in two other variations inserted by Beethoven into the pre-existing order of the 1819 draft. The next of these is variation 15. Thank you. Variation 15 sounds more humorous in context than it can taken out of context, because it follows and precedes two of the longest, most massive variation units of the whole set. A long, serious, slow variation, number 14, and then a pair of march variations, number 16 and 17. Other unusual features of variation 15 include its static harmonic plan, the striking shift in register of the left hand in the second half, and its role as a miniature, the shortest of all 33 variations. The contrasts in the work reach a peak after variations 15 to 17, and the order of variations is calculated to maximize the effect. There is literally a shock, in some cases, from one variation to the next, until variation 21, in which the structural parts of the variation itself are put into opposition. Then, in variation 25, Beethoven again brings back the melodic contour of the waltz, and once more in the original register in a third parody variation, which suggests a German dance in 3/8 time. At the end of the variation half I played is a humorous effect. The music should cadence later than it does. Instead, it turns from the expected A minor close dryly back to the C major of the beginning. The voice leading is somewhat aimless, and there are dissonant clashes between the bass and treble as well. This represents, then, the last of a series of periodic references back to the original theme. It is at this point, variation 25, that we begin to sense a consolidation in the large-scale form of the work. This formal consolidation involved groupings of variations. Variations 25 to 28, all fast ones, and then variations 29 to 31, all slow ones in minor, which together give the effect of a composite slow movement. This feature was a product of Beethoven's later phase of composition, when he built up the work from the simpler plan devised in 1819. Of the group of four fast variations, only variation 27 existed in 1819, and of the following group of the slow variations 29 to 31, only variation 30 existed. In expanding the work, Beethoven retained his basic ideas for 27 and 30, while using each of these as a middle member of an integrated sequence of variations. This casts a revealing light on variation 27 in relation to the theme, with its mechanical cobbler's patch sequences. Seizing the motive of a rising half step and third from the waltz, Beethoven concentrates this element so that it appears 24 times in the first 8 bars. His parody of the cobbler's patch he disdained becomes a kind of genetic stem cell infusing the variation, and the pungent dissonance of the half step is further intensified in variation 28, with its vertical layering of 4 dissonances on every strong beat, yielding 64 such clashes in the first 8 bars alone. Thank you. building up the group of fast variations, Beethoven shifts from one strong beat per measure in variation 25 to two impulses per measure in variation 26, and finally to a further telescoping of rhythm in variations 27 and 28. Beethoven offers us a last direct image of the waltz in variation 25, and then, through the increasing energy produced by rhythmic compression, the increasing rhythmic speed, culminating in the intense effect of variation 28, it's as if this image of the waltz is gradually obliterated. Then, in the last five variations, it's as if we've left Diabelli's waltz and the world it represents behind. As we've seen, in the 1819 draft, only variation 30 existed. At a later point then, Beethoven added 29 and 31 and let all three variations, each longer and more complex than the preceding, stand for a composite slow movement. But variations 29 and 31 and most of the other variations written in 1823 share another feature in common. Each of them might be regarded as involving parody, though not here in the sense of caricature or travesty. In the classical sense of the word, parody implies a reuse, but not travesty. In several of these variations, the parody involves an absorption or allusion to historical styles in the manner of an homage. Within this series of historical parodies, three of the references are to a composer Beethoven very much revered, Johann Sebastian Bach. Already in variation 24, we encounter a piece evocative of Bach's late idiom and closely akin to certain of the organ pieces from the third part of Bach's Klavierübung.
Thank you.
Variation 29 is a kind of Baroque lament evocative of Bach. A quality of bleak, austere sadness characterizes this variation. Variation 31, on the other hand, is a great largo that seems to allude specifically to Bach's Goldberg variations, the only other variation set really comparable in grandeur and scale to Beethoven's Diabelli set. The allusion is to the famous ornamented minor variation, number 25 of the Goldberg. The two share the same descending intervals, the same highly florid idiom. At the same time, variation 31 displays forward-looking stylistic traits, which have reminded more than one commentator of music subsequent to Beethoven, and in particular, that of Chopin. Here's the first half of variation 31. Beyond these references to Bach, we pass in the penultimate variation, or penultimate section, to a fugue that opens in a style reminiscent of Handel, with the repeated notes of the theme infused with rhythmic verve and treated in sequence with the countersubject. Fugue doesn't long continue in the realm of Handel. It soon embodies the robust manner of Beethoven's third period. Most fascinating of all is the final variation, which seems to allude on the surface to Mozart. It's a minuet and might bring to mind the famous G major minuet from Don Giovanni. Beethoven had already referred once to Mozart in this piece, in variation 22. Thank you. One recognizes here the very opening of Leporello's Notte, Giorno, Fatica. On the surface, of course, those words might seem to relate to the Diabelli project. Leporello is complaining that he's working all day and all night for a master who doesn't appreciate him. By 1823, Diabelli, whom Beethoven enjoyed calling Diabolus, was certainly badgering Beethoven to finish the variations. Diabelli did, in fact, publish them as a separate volume beside the collective publication that he envisioned from the outset. But still more is involved here. Other aspects of the piece also recall features of Don Giovanni, not with reference to specific passages, but in the broader sense of compositional ideas. A dimension of variation 22 that fits the Diabelli variations is the character of Leporello himself, which is evoked here. Leporello is critical of his master, but remains faithful to him. Just as Beethoven is critical of the theme, but nevertheless faithful to it in exploiting its motivic possibilities. And at the same time, Leporello is capable of assuming disguises, as in the sextet of the second act of Mozart's opera. After this point in the Diabelli variations, the variations themselves seem to be capable of assuming disguises, as if they were something other than they seem to be. These parallels could be discussed further, but we've mentioned a few of the elements involved, in particular the references to other composers, Bach, Handel, Mozart. Yet another allusion is offered by variation 23, which is a parody of keyboard virtuosity whose figuration bears a conspicuous resemblance to the first etude of a series of piano etudes written by Beethoven's acquaintance in London, the pianist Johann Baptist Cramer. Reference of all becomes explicit in the coda as an allusion to the last movement of Beethoven's own last piano sonata that he'd finished a year earlier in 1822, the celebrated Arietta movement of Opus 111. Thomas Mann and others have described this variation movement as sublime music that transcends time and carries the classical sonata to a point of no return. However that may be, Beethoven himself seems to have thought quite highly of the movement too, and it is remarkable that the Arietta movement, as sublime as it is, was itself linked to the Diabelli project. Although no two themes could be more different in their affective quality, they are nonetheless similar in their musical structure. The Arietta begins like this. But Diabelli's waltz, you'll recall, goes like this. You'll hear what they have in common, and the parallels extend beyond these opening phrases. This has been pointed out at various times and has always seemed a fascinating but puzzling relationship. Still more intriguing is the impact this movement had on the end of the Diabelli set. The Opus 111 Arietta movement begins with a slow, spacious theme, whereas the unfolding variations gradually increase the rhythmic activity, so that by variation three, the musical character is highly agitated. Beginning in variation four, the rhythmic texture suggests an almost motionless pulsation. In the last stages, these rhythmic levels are superimposed, and the protracted trills of the coda seem to stand for a kind of inner stillness. This musical procedure has much to do with the profound effect of the arietta movement. But, strange as it seems, there was a kinship between the arietta movement and the Diabelli variations all along, a kinship that seems natural when we recall that Beethoven had all of these variations in his desk awaiting completion. While working on another set of variations, the arietta movement, Beethoven let the intervallic framework of the first work intrude upon the second. What is noteworthy is that when Beethoven came back to finish the Diabelli set, he surely sought to find some kind of culmination that went beyond the waltz. If this lack of a conclusion delayed completion of the project, it was the arietta movement that offered a solution to the challenge. An innovation of several of the later variations composed in 1823 is that the structural framework of the theme itself is altered. One of Beethoven's strategies is to take those opening measures, which are harmonically static, and compress them, thereby altering the structural proportions of the theme. In this sense, several of the late variations adopt the proportions not of Diabelli's waltz, but instead those of the Opus 111 arietta. At the end of the work, furthermore, this relationship is confirmed by audible thematic parallels. All we have to do is play the closing bars of the arietta movement. And then a section from the coda of the variations. To notice the relationship. It is practically a quotation. And actually, the reference goes beyond quotation. It involves a reuse of that framework in the arietta that contributes so much to its power. The rhythmic development of increasing motion, finally reaching an unmeasured pulsation. This procedure is adapted so that it stands behind the minuet, guiding its development. The minuet, which is reminiscent of Mozart at first, gradually becomes more and more elaborate through three successive subdivisions of its rhythm. At a later point in the coda, there is another step to the process, which is linked to a climactic passage in the middle of the arietta movement. Thus, the mysteriously suspended musical texture outlining a minor sixth in the high register in Opus 111 parallels an ethereal passage that outlines a major third in the coda of the Diabelli variations. In a sense, Beethoven has modeled the minuet and coda of the Diabelli variations on the structural plan of the entire arietta movement. There is still more to this artistic strategy. What Beethoven has done is to place at the end of the work a series of historical parodies that survey the history of music that mattered most to him, ending with an allusion to his own work, a minuet that stands for more than just a minuet. It ends by absorbing Beethoven's own self-reference to Opus 111, the last movement of his last sonata. If we think about some parts of Don Giovanni, the opera Beethoven had already quoted, some interesting parallels come to light. In the first finale of Don Giovanni is a famous ballroom minuet, one that Mozart has so calculated that he can superimpose two additional dances on it for dramatic effect. And in the second finale, Mozart also has a passage in which he recalls pieces by other composers, operatic tunes of the day, with the last allusion representing a self-quotation from Mozart's own Figaro, a work that had been given in Prague a year before that city heard the premiere of Don Giovanni. So this idea of referring outside of the work and then ending with a self-quotation seems to have a resonance in Don Giovanni as well. One might be tempted, in light of relationships like these, to dwell upon the goal-directedness or teleological character of the conclusion of the Diabelli variations, stressing Beethoven's sublime transformations of Diabelli's cobbler's patch. Yet at the same time, he retains a memory of the original context, that is, of the original waltz. It has been said that a fairy godmother of creative process studies is the spirit of paradox. There is something deliciously paradoxical in Beethoven's open ending, recalling as it does the characteristic repeated notes and rising sixths G to E from the middle of the second half of Diabelli's theme. Even the final chord of the variations is a surprise. The long-range backward glance and conclusion on a weak beat conveys a sense of unfinished business, of a witty, smiling gaze, suggesting perhaps that the creative process is not exhausted after all, but that even more variations could have followed. In providing the real-life trigger and springboard, Diabelli's Schusterfleck remained indispensable. Yet the brainstorm that ensued conformed to Beethoven's favorite saying, "Ars longa, vita brevis." Art is long, life is short.